Thank you so much, Ellen, and thank you, Chris. It's great to be back at the Art Barge. Those of you who know me know that I love boats and I love the water, and we presented, the Parrish Art Museum presented a Parrish Roadshow here last summer that was one of my favorites, with the artist Saskia Friedrich, who had a piece floating just outside of these doors. So I'm thrilled to be with Laurie. It's been about 13 years since I first met Laurie in Houston, where she was the first artist in residence at NASA. I, at the time, was running a small nonprofit called Aurora Picture Show, and we had been renting Laurie's movies, which is something that nonprofits could do from places like Video Data Bank and Electronic Arts Intermix. And one of the first films that we showed by Laurie really stuck with me, and I was rewatching it today. It's called What You Mean We, and it's from 1986. I don't know if anyone's ever seen it, but in have people seen it? A few people, okay. So in it, some of the themes that were continuous through Laurie's work are present in this video, which she uses technology to develop a clone of herself as an artist so that she can have a collaborator who can do a lot of the work. So in it, she's
kind of... The press work.
The press work, yeah.
Yes. Just the press stuff.
Yeah. In it, she's sort of reading a newspaper and having this conversation with a smaller, more masculine version of herself and using a vocal harmonizer to change her voice. And so that early work really stood out to me, and I think some of the themes of technology and duets and the failure of certain kinds of technology are come into play in that work. In 2003, when Laurie was in Texas, we asked her to be our first artist to receive the Aurora Award, which was the honor that we did at our gala at Aurora Picture Show. And then when I moved back east in 2011, Laurie needed some extras for a film she was shooting. So we reconnected when she was just beginning to shoot different parts of Heart of a Dog. And my daughters actually were able to participate in that. So anyway, we've come sort of full circle here because our gala was also a very wet one that year, and the technology was also giving us some challenges. So I wanted to talk to you probably first and foremost about one of the things I appreciate most about your work, and that is that you have, through the years, always maintained a political voice. Which is not easy to do and not always popular in the arts. So I thought we would talk a little bit about that and talk about Habeas Corpus, which was the project you presented at the Park Avenue Armory last October, which was one of my favorite experiences of recent memory.
You know, it's, that is, there was a project that was, it took a very long time to do. And as you mentioned the word failure in what you're saying, and many of the things that I have done start with failure. I really depend on it. I'm kind of happy when something like that happens because it gives me a chance to think, is that really how I wanted it to work? And I'll give you one example before talking about Habeas Corpus, because I learned this a very long time ago, and it was when I was working on, I was writing an essay, this is the late 70s, and I was writing it on an automatic typewriter with a motor. So I'm typing away, and I'm thinking, this is kind of good. And then I read it, and I was like, oh, this is so pompous, so stupid, and I was really depressed. I put my head down on my hands, and then I heard the motor of the typewriter coming to the table and up through my hands into my head, and I was like, okay, I'm gonna build a singing table. So I built this table in the basement of the Museum of Modern Art because they had asked me to do a project. And of course, most of these things start with, I don't have an idea for a project. I don't have any ideas, no ideas. What am I gonna do? I'm a kind of hands-on person. So I just try to get an idea by starting something, just start something. And then it looks really stupid. And then try not to be really depressed by that. So anyway, with the table, and also I had a lot of setbacks with that. But the way that worked was it was a table that looked like a table. And inside is sound sources. In this case, it was cassette decks and things that but then some electronics that compressed the sound, drove it up a steel rod, made contact with the bottom of the table, then you put your elbows on points of the table, and it's like putting on very, very powerful headphones. You hear the sounds coming through bone conduction. So, and the thing about this is that worked only really with bass sounds, because bass frequencies, the waves look like this, and they're very easy to control and force in a certain direction. Treble, so I used a lot of like bass lines. So you hear a Fender Rhodes bass line in one ear, and the other ear is an acoustic piano doing the same bass line, and then they would slowly pan so that you start getting this very spatial feeling in your head. I always wanted to make language work in that situation, so I tried to filter it and do all sorts of stuff electronically. But language is built on with fricatives and sounds that are otherwise all you hear without the sharp definition of the fricative. So high frequency sounds are very hard to control. So finally I was able to do that, and so the first sentence that I forced through the system was a line from a 17th century British metaphysical love poet named George Herbert. And it was a poem that he wrote to music. And one of the lines that I liked and used was, now I and you without a body move. So you hear, in one ear you hear now I, and then in you without a body, and the word move slowly pans through your head. And it's this wonderful sensation of, you know, your head is a huge, like, empty barn, which you kind of suspected it was anyway, you know, just big empty place, you know, not something packed with, you know, brains and meat and stuff. But it's a very spatial sensation, very, very free, spatial, resonant thing. So that when you use your body as a sound system, it's very exciting. I'm going to tell you a little bit later when we talk about some things that I'm working on actually today. I have my VR team from Taiwan here, and we're working here in Springs on some crazy projects that I'll describe to you. At the risk of babbling, I'm going to just answer your question.
Maybe.
which was this project though in last fall was done at the Park Avenue Armory in New York, big cavernous space. And it was, I have to tell you, it was the result of several steps of failure. So the very first one was, I was invited to come to Krems, and this is like 1998, to do a sound installation in their 13th century, in a 13th century church. Now this had originally been a church, and then it became in the 15th, 16th century, kind of pilgrim flop house on the way to Jerusalem. People would stop there, and then it became a cultural center, sort of like this art barge has a different, you know, has a lot of kind of steps along the way. So this one, I was there, and they asked me to do a sound installation. Can you make this something architectural, a sound work that's very architectural? And that was challenging to me because I like to work with sound in a physical way and see how it relates to the building and what it can be. So, but I had no ideas. And so every day the curators are going, what's your idea? I was like, you know, and it was getting really embarrassing. So, you know, I was getting really depressed, and I also was trying to hide from them a little bit. So I went up this stairs to this bell tower of the church, and when I got up there, I looked out, and in this, the middle of this perfect little Austrian town of Krems is a maximum security prison. I'm like, whoa, usually we put them out of town, you know, like up the river, not right in your face. So I'm in the bell tower, and I looked over, and there's a guard tower and a guy with a machine gun. And so I'm in the bell tower, he's in the guard tower, and I'm like, frank, frank, blah, blah, blah. So I came down the steps and I said to the curators, we're going to build a video studio in the prison, and then we're going to make a life-size cast of one of the prisoners. And then we're going to put that cast in the church, and we're going to beam, the prisoner's going to sit there very still, for 3 months. And we're going to beam his image from the prison to the church onto this cast. Like, imagine a three-dimensional movie kind of thing. And surprisingly, they said, okay. Like, sounds good. I said, stop me now, you know? Because, you know, you get an idea and you just, well, yeah, you wing it, you know? And then you have to do it, so. Like, oh. And then they said, the next 2 days, they said, we actually, Austrian law, we found, forbids it means that the prisoner no longer owns his own image, so you cannot use it. Now, image ownership, of course, is a big deal for us now in the 21st century. Like, who really owns your image? It's a really fascinating kind of thing that hope we get to talk a little bit about later. But later is piling up. I'm so anyway, I was good. Okay, like off the hook. Okay, good. A little bit relieved because I'm thinking at this point, you know, maybe taking a prisoner's image and putting it on the apse of a church isn't the smartest idea I've ever had in very conservative Austria. Very conservative Austria. Is that the? So, you know, because I was saying I wanted to do it because I wanted to kind of look at telepresence, the function of telepresence in our culture. And the attitude towards the body of the church and the prison. So incarnation, incarceration, there, not there. You know, what does that mean to remote imagery like that? So anyway, a couple of days after that, they said they'd talk to their attorney general, and the attorney general loved the project, and it's on. Gave us special dispensation. Note the clerical like language, dispensation. So it was on again. So it was back and forth. And then finally, for some reason, and I really forget what it was, some logistical thing, that didn't happen. So then about a few months later, the Whitney asked me to do something. And I said, let's do a collaboration between Sing Sing and the Whitney. Let's look at two guarded institutions. What are you keeping in there? And why are you guarding those things? You know, so for several months, we worked on this, and we found a bunch of meditators at Sing Sing, and there were a lot of people who were dragged in under the Rockefeller drug law. A lot of artists in Sing Sing, by the way, who got rounded up, and we had a technical system worked out with a satellite feed that was going to go from Sing Sing to the Whitney, and which this is the old Whitney, which looks a lot like a prison anyway. Yes. Yeah, looks like you can pick the shoppers off with your guns. You know, no, just a bastion. You know, like what? Why is it built like that? Like a anyway, also a beautiful building in some other ways. But anyway, so that eventually also didn't happen. And I never really found out exactly why, because it was what I heard was it was just considered a little too political at that point. One of the things, of course, about that moment was that was when we realized that New York State, you know, it's big business here in New York State. It's in fact, I think, third after insurance and a couple other things is outside of New York City is prisons. When prisons were privatized, of course, what do you need? Customers. So a lot of people got dragged into that system, and it's, you know, so I was thinking, well, that is like, so anyway, that Whitney project got canceled. Then the next version of this was a curator, Germano Chaland, a really wonderful person, who said, I like this project, and within half an hour, he got a permission from San Vittorio Prison in Milan and the Prada Foundation in Milan to collaborate on this project. And so, as you can imagine, the trickiest part of something like this, as is often in when artists work with other people, is exploitation. So I'm working with a prisoner and then sign it, and that's my art project. It's like really queasy. So I spent a lot of time at the prison talking to prisoners and just seeing if anyone was interested in doing this with me, because it was a collaboration. Now, this prison was a sanatorio in Milan. It's a beautiful building, but it's built on prison oculus principles. So there are lots of almost literary movements that are based on the architecture of this kind of all-seeing eye prison. Anyway, it's a very famous prison, and the people I talked to were, they were in there, they were white-collar guys, and these were white-collar weasels. I mean, they were they were the guys that lawyers, basically, who would basically dismantle the Italian economy. You know, these kind of guys, very smart. Spoke Greek and Latin, were writing their books, they could have wine, they could have knives, all their friends could visit them, they were all wearing Armani, you know, and everything was right except for the shoes, because you looked down the shoes and they were like slippers, because these guys are going nowhere ever. They're like serving multiple life sentences. So anyway, I'm talking to these guys about looking for my collaborator. And because these guys are expert in they're lawyers. They're expert in manipulating how your focus is, you know, what you're doing and how they watch you and they. So we're talking, and I think we're talking about me finding a collaborator, but no, they had decided who it was. And I'm gradually talking to a guy over in the corner. And because they had decided who it was, and they were just like subtly doing it, because you know this is like very, very suave way, and I didn't see it. You know, I didn't see it. So anyway, I'm talking to the guy who they had chosen, named Santino, which means saint, and it's a bank robber and murderer, and also a writer, a wonderful writer, as many of these guys were. They had a lot of time to write, you know, and they were wonderful writers. And anyway, and I enjoyed my time talking to them a lot. So anyway, I said to Santino, if you and I work on this, how do you see this project? And he says, I see this as a virtual escape. And I said, you're my man. We had a really interesting time working on this together. He totally understood what he was doing. He practiced for a long time, sitting very still. He was very proud to do this. Very proud. It was a really interesting collaboration. He wrote a lot about it. We wrote beautiful things about it. So we did it, and he was in a huge room at the Prada Foundation, and it was not what I expected at all. I was, you know, when you came up to him, and he was like this, and he was not like a prisoner. He was like a judge. He was like your distant father. You kind of go, Dad, you there? Not there? Not there? You know, where, you know, it was like, because he could see enough into sitting in the prison. So he's sitting in the prison. He's sitting there anyway. He's sitting in the prison, and there's a feed from the Prada Foundation to the prison so that he can line himself up so that his image is correctly on the statue, so that it's, you know, the knees can't be like this, they have to be that. And it's also a really interesting cubist sort of experiment, because if you're projecting onto a three-dimensional object, you can't do right angles, because the projector will hit there and not here. So the person has to sit like in a business class seat, like this, so that the planes are not right angles. Yeah. So it's all sort of forcing perspective. It was fascinating to work on sculpture, like sculpture and film project like that. The next version, and that was called Life. The next version was, and I always wanted to do it in the United States, because prisons, and it's a very troubling situation for most Americans. I mean, how we can have the most prisoners of anywhere in the world. Why? We have the more bad guys, quite, you know, and when we saw it triple, when suddenly it was privatized, you start to realize it has to do with, you know, the marketplace as much as something else. So I had imagined when the armory asked me to do something. The armory is a huge, basically originally military place. and it was built for the 13th Regiment, called the Silk Stocking Regiment. And these were guys who were basically, they're the same people who still live on the Upper East Side. Okay, so they had a regiment, and they were super stylish. Like they had, like, this was a like Civil War area, and they kept being mustered, their regiment kept being mustered for the Civil War, and they would get out their flags, their horses, their hats, they weren't that good at fighting. But they were really good in parades and like just the whole, you know, super styling guys, you know. And so they kept being sent back, you know. Thanks. But, you know, we have enough flags. So anyway, so this is a kind of like club. It was originated as a club for the regiment. And so it's full of these wood panel rooms, and its history is really a deep military social history. So it's got a vibe. And it also still smells like horses, which I really like because I grew up with horses. And you can still smell all the horse shit everywhere, you know. It's a huge, huge area. So anyway, I know this is a long answer to you.
No, it's great.
It's almost over. So anyway, they asked me to do something. I said, I would like to do this version with American prisoners. And I would like to work with 12 prisons in upstate New York. And there would be 12 statues and feeds coming from these prisons. And it would look like the Hall of Hatshepsut in Egypt, you know, these statues like this. And then live feeds from the prisons. And we worked for many months. We met a lot of wardens. We went to a lot of prisons and talked to a lot of people. And I mean, prisons are, you know, in Georgia, there are lots of cameras in prisons, which usually don't go together. Cameras and prisons usually don't go together at all, but except as surveillance watching the prisoners. But there are a lot of reality shows coming from Georgian prisons now. You know, there are lots of, I mean, Orange is the New Black is no joke, you know, romanticizing prisons, thinking that they might be, you know. Anyway, so we talked to a lot of those people, and it was coming together. It was like really exciting. I was like, this is really gonna be something I really wanna do. Then Homeland Security stepped in and they said, you will never, ever do this project in the United States of America. And I could not see the upside in that. You know? I was like, you mean like never, right? like never ever. So we had worked for so long. It was really disappointing. We had gotten a lot of people involved in it, the Center for Constitutional Rights and people who were representing, you know, prisoners. And so anyway, I went to Plan B. Plan B, you probably all have your Plan Bs. My Plan B was really lame. It involved miniature ponies. And I was going to have a lot, fill the armory with miniature ponies and small kids dressed as cowboys with little stubble and weather that would be sweeping through the armory. And it was, you know,
had not heard this chapter.
Yeah. That was Plan B. And we were pretty far down the road of Plan B. And it had a lot of drawings, and I started to, this isn't so bad, you know. And all of the press photographs for that armory thing, we brought miniature ponies in for the press shoot, you know. So see these all their, because, you know, a year ahead, people want to go, okay, so what's the poster going to look like? And I was like, I don't even know what I'm going to do, like, much less the poster. It's like, so anyway, then a little bit, so we're going along with Plan B, and then a friend said, you know, I have a friend in London who, and they're a group of lawyers called Reprieve. And they represent people on death row. And they also represent the detainees in Guantanamo. And we're gonna just put you in touch with them. And so I was like, okay. And so I called this group in London, Reprieve. And talking to someone on the phone, and I'm trying to explain the project. And it's taken me a while to explain this to you, like what it is to project a person and what time means in a situation like this, and what a three-dimensional sculpture is, and why I would be working with people in prison. And so I'm kind of like talking a little too fast because, you know, like when you have an idea, you're like, I realized I'm really babbling. And this lawyer is like, I'm going, and then it's a three-dimensional sculpture of, and the person sits there very still in it. And then I just stopped talking for a second because I thought, there's a long silence here. And instead of saying, which she could easily have said, thank you for so much for your telling me about your fascinating project. She said, tell me more. And that was Kat Craig, who's the lead lawyer at Reprieve. And so she said, you know, eventually she said, you know, actually, we're working with the detainees in Guantanamo, and we're working with one person I'm going to see if there's a possibility that he might be interested in doing this. So he lives in West Africa now, and he's no longer there. He was the youngest detainee. He was captured when he was 14, and he was there till he was 20. And like about 95% of the people there in Guantanamo, he had absolutely nothing. You know more about, you know, Al Qaeda than this guy did. He was swept up in a raid that was you get the prisoners you need. So we needed Saudis because Saudis were the ones who we needed, and he was a kid who is a Chadian citizen and a Saudi, and he went to study in Pakistan at his uncle's computer school, and he was swept up at 14 and just knew really nothing about any of this. He was in a mosque, so he was taken and to a couple of places in the Mid East and then to Guantanamo, where for 8 years he was tortured, and we did really bad things to this person.
Kept in solitary.
Yeah, solitary. I mean, it was, we cut him everywhere. You know, the first person who was his interrogator was a woman who said, think of me as your mother as he's being tortured. You know, but we couldn't say any of this because our lawyer said, well, here's what you can say and here's what you can't. So, for example, the very first thing that we did was declare all of the detainees non-persons. So immediately, boom, that solves the problem of having to give them any rights whatsoever. So the Geneva Convention out the window, so on. Second is, you know, for example, there was a huge number of suicides at Guantanamo, huge number. And suddenly, bingo, there are none. Like, what happened? Well, there were a number, in fact, a spiking number of self-destructive behaviors resulting in death. Spike in those. We were also not allowed to say that doctors were at every torture session. We had to say behavioral science consultancy teams were at every session with the detainees. Okay, so anyway, Mohammed's story, I went to Africa to meet Mohammed. And who I met, or the person I met, was a deeply charming, lovely person. I don't know how he survived, probably because he was the youngest, but he got a lot of help from the older guys there. I explained the project, and then again, so I'm in a hotel room in West Africa with a little sculpture and projecting an image onto it and saying, okay, so now this is going to be you, Mohammed, but really big. And I thought, what? How could it? It's so hard to understand it. I love being an artist because you have to work with real things, with real stuff. You know, real stuff, it's not just ideas, it's things and light and clay and all the stuff that's like right here. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just the stuff. And so anyway, he was really interested in doing this. Why? Because he said, I want to help my brothers in Guantanamo. And I said, Mohammed, you know, it's an art project, I'm not sure that's going to help your brothers. But I can tell you that if you tell your story and you let us tell your story, that a lot of America, it won't be okay with a lot of Americans. We're like in the dark about a lot of what's going on there. You know, when somebody asked me what I was working on and they said Guantanamo, it's like you hit someone. It's like, we have many, many taboos in this country. And we don't know a lot about what's going on there. Because we think we live in an information-rich culture. We do not. Mm-hmm. We do not. There are so many things that are just like black holes. You know, don't know a thing about it. So anyway, I learned a lot about Guantanamo and working on this project. And what we did in the Armory was we built a statue the size of the Lincoln Memorial. And beamed his image live from Africa. And for several days, he was there. And there was a camera up way up in the top of the Armory, giving him a view of the Armory. And we thought it would just be so that he could adjust his... We had a big team. We built a studio in Africa so that we could do all of this tech stuff. And it was tech-challenging work to get a live image that size, you know, in real time. So he was there. And this camera, also we realized that people realized that he could see them if they got close to the statue. So what happened with that thing was really strange. So many people came to this, and partly because some of the music was like sort of overwhelming, people just kind of... They began to bring their instruments and play with this thing, and they started. Other people came in and did ballet all day, and you're like, what? Or wrote, and they came and just stayed in the Armory all day because it was a kind of immersive kind of thing with a big and mirror ball we used. Don't never underestimate a mirror ball, but this huge statue. We also provided a lot of information about, we made a film of Mohammed talking about his experience and what it meant to him and what happened to him there and asking, and then we did a big program. We also had the lawyers made a very huge info-rich portrait of him so that you could go see that he was actually never charged with anything, as none of the people there were ever charged with anything. First of all, we couldn't scrape up any evidence, mainly. And second, if you don't charge someone, then they'll always be guilty. So after he's out of the prison, because he went through so much, finally, you know, you just get rid of him. And then we say, okay, to other countries, you have to take this person who was a detainee and he was a suspected terrorist, so you have that branded on your head the rest of your life. Makes it very hard for them to get citizenship, so they just are dumped in these countries. So that happens to all of them. And then we think, oh, those are dangerous terrorists who might be coming back. They are so exhausted by the end of this. They're so broken. They're so, you know, they're not going to come back and do anything, you know. And on the other hand, okay, so Mohammed's there. We're talking to him on our team is talking to the team in Africa and how's it going. He realizes, and everybody starts realizing that he can see them. So they who have learned his story come up and they make contact with this guy, and they're going like, we didn't have an audio feed because I was very afraid that people would go, you're a terrorist, you know, the kind of stuff. They came up and they went, I'm sorry. It was like, whoa, information, yeah. Information. And when it flows, you know, it's dangerous, you know. So yesterday, well, actually, I should say, at one point, Kweku Mandela wanted to help us with this project, and I just had a meeting with Kweku yesterday. He's Nelson Mandela's grandson because he liked this project, and now he's trying to twist my arm into making a film about it. I'm like, oh, not another one. Anyway, he was there. And Mohammed had read a lot of his grandfather's writing when he was in Guantanamo. And so we said, okay, Mohammed, like right now, Kweku Mandela is standing in the Armory looking at you. And that was when Mohammed started to cry. because he said, you mean the grandson of Nelson Mandela is here and I am being projected onto a statue the size of an American president who freed the slaves. And that, he Muhammad only got like that when he talked about people who helped him. Mm-hmm. He knew he'd gotten caught into a thing that was just spiraling out of control. All the guys there knew that. And a few weeks ago, I was in touch with Muhammad, who then, you know, went through this whole process of, you know, being, suddenly he was not a person who was a suspected terrorist. He was suddenly being referred to in the press thing as an art collaborator. And he's like, whoa, whoa. He's a deeply charming guy. He's also hysterically funny. He would be such a great stand-up comedian. I'm trying to get him some gigs as a stand-up comic because he has a lot to say. And but he said, so Mohammed, what's on your mind these days? Because we got to be pretty good friends. And now how am I, except through art, ever going to get to be friends with a goat herder from Saudi Arabia? You know, it's not going to happen otherwise. So that I have technology and art to thank for that friendship. So I said, Muhammad, what are you doing these days? What are you interested in? He said, you know, what I'm really interested in working on is women's rights. I was like, you know, break my heart. I was like, whoa. A person who went like this instead of like this, you know, who just... And that's also, then I realized, of course, that's how he survived this, too, because he's a person who could, and he wrote some really, really beautiful things about what it was like to be there, and some crazy, crazy surrealistic things. Like, there's one detainee who told his interrogator, and they see these guys, the interrogators, every day. And by the way, there are many, many levels in Guantanamo. It's a complicated social structure in which a number of the detainees really like the American guards, really actually admire Americans. You know, it's complicated. You know, it's a complicated thing. Like American culture, like the freewheeling kind of style, like the cartoons, like the culture. You know, so it's not a kind of black and white thing, as nothing is. But anyway, so he was telling me about a dream that one of the detainees had, and he told his interrogator, I dreamed that there were, let's see, how did this go? That there was a submarine in Guantanamo Bay, and that all of these, that it was coming to rescue some of the prisoners. And it goes on a sort of in dream language, and the kind of dream language that you dread when somebody goes, I had this dream, and you know they start telling you their dream, and you're going, no, please don't tell me your dream. My uncle's walking down a road. No, wait, it was my father. No, wait, my uncle. And you're like, don't tell me your dream. It's not a movie that you just saw last night. It's like only you know the meaning of the dream. Anyway, so this guy told his dream of the submarine that was coming to rescue the detainees in Guantanamo. And of course the interrogator told them, and that night the entire bay was filled with US helicopters and ships looking for the submarine that someone had dreamed. This is a dark dream that's going on down there. And I mean, when you start living in a dark dream, I mean, you realize it. The world that's made of language and dreams, you know. I mean, we're going through with the elections right now. It's all about stories. It's all about these dreams, these really feverish, weird dreams. And they get put out as some kind of reality. And I mean, my art form is stories. So I liked, this is election season for me is like, this is the greatest thing because, you know, it's everyone tells their story. I'm gonna tell you a story about how I think the world is, how it got that way, where it is, where we're going. And you vote for the person whose story you like the best.
Yeah.
It's like, on that, you know, who's telling you the best story? The one that really resonates with you. How it relates to reality, well, that's kind of a different thing. And what is that anyway? What is that anyway? So this is one of the things we're doing in this VR project now is trying to find these stories that have this relationship between second and third and fourth dimensions that are are so suddenly you're in a chair, you're wearing these goggles, suddenly you're in a chair, you feel it, you look around the room, but you don't have a body. You look down and through the trickery of VR, you don't have a body. But then you can reach out your hands if you want to, and then in one of the programs, suddenly they're like hooves. And you're moving them around, but they're hooves. And you're like, whoa! And it's funny, like being in that world, which I've been in like in the last week, because I've been working with this group of people. It's amazing how familiar it is to just really be a mental entity in a way. Like, you know, even in a way that you're sort of surprised if somebody takes your picture and you're going, no, that's not me. You know, I'm the person looking out at this. You know, I'm not the one who's here in the way that we think we're here. So anyway, it's a really so the body and the presence of that and the way it relates to stories is how I'm kind of it's always somehow crops up in whatever I'm working on one way or another. So. And also with that piece, the video piece, that was an early version of this kind of thing.
And Obama sent some of his staff to see habeas corpus, didn't he? Yeah. It's very interesting because art has been so marginalized in politics, it's not even part of the conversation anymore. And I know one of your early experiences was writing to JFK. and you actually got a response from him.
Oh, yeah,
and and a collection of quotes about the value of the arts.
Yeah.
And I have one I just want to read.
Oh, okay.
Because I think it's so remarkable that a president would say this. If more politicians knew poetry and more poets knew politics, I am convinced the world would be a better place in which to live. This is a speech at Harvard in 1956.
You know, he was, he was a poet.
Yeah.
And but, I mean, art has been marginalized, but politics has also been marginalized. You know, when you realize, are we talking about any of the issues here? Not really, mm-hmm. not at all. You know, so dialogue has been marginalized. So, but I'll tell you the story of this Kennedy thing was, I think it was. February, and somebody said, hey, I have tickets to your show at the Kennedy Center. I was like, what show at the Kennedy Center? I'd forgotten I had a show, because I was looking at the calendar. I was, and then I remembered, I got to put this letter in, because when I was a 12-year-old twerp, I wrote to Jack Kennedy, because he was in the Wisconsin primaries at that time. And I said, dear Senator Kennedy, I really admire the way you're running your campaign in Wisconsin, and I'm running for president of my student council, and could you give me some advice? I don't really remember when you were 12. You were a jerk, you know? I was like a twerp. You think my life is more important than anybody else's life. You know, I was like, so anyway, I wrote this letter to him, and he wrote me back. And he wrote me a long letter that said, and I remember this so well, and I still have it, find out what the students want and promise it. I was like, in other words, don't be an ideologue, be a representative. Find out what these people want and promise it. Although I think Winston Churchill was the one who said, in relation to Brexit and other things, the best argument against democracy is a 5-minute conversation with the average voter. Oh. That was Winston. And there, he was getting quoted a lot in Brexit days. But so anyway, I wrote back to Kennedy a couple months later, and I said, "Dear Senator Kennedy, thank you for your advice. I'm really sorry I haven't gotten back to you earlier. Been very busy. I won my election, and best wishes in yours." He's like, "Okay." So guess what happens next? He sends a telegram, congratulations, to our little town in Illinois, and a box, a long white, one of those long white boxes with red rose, 10 or 12 red roses.
Oh my gosh.
And on the front page of our little local newspaper, the Glen Ullin News, local girl receives roses from Jack Kennedy. Every single woman in town is like, Jack! She was so romantic. We did this show at the Kennedy Center, and it was very moving because they gave us a book at the end of this thing, and I'm going to be playing with the same cellist that I'm going to be playing with on Saturday at the dog concert. Gave us a book, and it was these quotes from Kennedy, and they were so beautiful. They were things like, art and poetry are the heart of the country. That is what animates our country. And you were like, who has said that since then?
Yeah.
You know, that poetry is the, I mean, he's an Irish mystic and also wonderful politician and schemer and, you know, all sorts of complicated things. But he had great respect for art. And loved it, and loved books. He loved books. So, and loved nature. And so that made such a huge impression on me to read what he'd read and think of how different things are now, where you would never say that. In fact, have you heard any of the candidates talk about the function of art and culture?
No.
It's like we're invisible. You know, and we're an industry also. I mean, New York City is a huge cultural industry of all kinds of things, generating a lot of stuff. And zip, no. If it's about, you know, military, so what, you know, whatever else, but not the arts. And so, entering that fray, the political fray right now, is it's such a shouting match. You know, at this point, that it's almost hard to figure out how to do it. I mean, although I think it's important to do, well, I don't know, I think it's important. I think it's good to do something, probably, but when people ask me, do you think art should make the world a better place? I just think better for who? Better for you and your friends and the art world, or what are you talking about, even? Better for who? It's a very complicated question. It doesn't stop me from trying to make something beautiful or something interesting. It doesn't stop me, but it doesn't become a motivation to, I mean, I had a grandmother who was a missionary and she tried to, you know, make the world a better place. Mm-hmm. Went to Japan and to try to convert Buddhists to Southern Baptists. Didn't bother to learn Japanese, you know.
Oh my God. Just
sang, and she thought, don't get the idea, you know. They did not get the idea. They didn't know what she was doing there. You know, it's very hard. Now, one thing that she did do was she was very vain. She was a Southern lady who had a great skill for making beautiful hats, really, really elaborate, like roses, violets, veils. Great. I mean, they were really something. And so the Japanese are looking at what's the hat with a hat? Whoa, that's an art form. So she taught them how to make these kinds of hats. She saw them cutting bonsai, and she was a rose gardener. So she said, I want to know how to cut bonsai like that, how to cut roses like that. So they taught her how to do that. And that was the exchange. And that's a lot. You know, to convince somebody else to change their mind about politics or religion or what, you know, that's a pretty tough sell. So, that's never really been my own ambition to try to make things better for the world. I don't even know what that means, really. It's too big a thing. And so when, you know, these discussions about art and politics, it's just like, I don't even know what to say.
Yeah. So. You know, there, in terms of language, which is obviously a big part of storytelling, you often, you've referred to language, well, Burroughs quote, language is a virus, language is a disease communicated by mouth. And also Wittgenstein, language has the power to create the world. And I did hear you commenting a little bit about the election season. I won't stay on politics, I promise. but I thought you might talk a little bit about your use of language and this phrase that you've used that every time you tell a story, you forget it.
Yeah, I mean, that was in the context of stories that are ones that are self-identifying sort of stories. If somebody says, what kind of kid were you? You know, you have your go-to kid story that you drag out. I was a shy kid, I was a punk, I just did sports. You know, this is a little snapshot of who you were as a kid. And it's not meant to really do anything. It's not. And that person who's asking you isn't really asking you anyway. It's not, now when your shrink says, what kind of childhood do you have? That's a 10-year answer, you know, but mostly people don't want to really know that much. In fact, you know, when I talk to the young artists, sometimes they're going, I couldn't call myself an artist because I'm like not an artist like Van Gogh or Jackson Pollock. They were artists, but I can't call myself an artist because, you know, and I have to say, you know, I usually say something like, you know, I have to tell you that not many people care that much about what you call yourself. They care about that as much as you care about what they, you know, what they say. So knock yourself out, call yourself an artist, you know. It's like, it's a word, it's a powerful word, but, you know, words have power, so then maybe you'll be one. But Burroughs was always one of my favorite writers just because he knew that the slippery part and talked about it really well. This quote of language is a virus from outer space. Always that was a really wonderful thing for a writer to say, that it's a disease. Mm-hmm. Mouth-to-mouth disease, you know, that can be really dangerous. But also, probably what affected me more about Burroughs was that he was so funny. You just read his stuff and you just can't stop laughing, you know, and I really trust that. I really trust laughter, probably more than most things, because it's so physical. It's, is that another one of those flash flood things? Did everyone get your flash flood alert? Yes. Like, oh, no. Like, do we have to know all of that stuff?
We should stay here.
Yeah, just stay here. Yeah, save you, the barge.
Well, we should talk about the two upcoming programs. You're going to be screening Heart of a Dog at Guildhall, and you're also going to be doing your concert for dogs at Longhouse Reserve. And I know you said you didn't want to become the artist who did concerts for dogs, but here we are.
Now I am that artist. Yeah.
But Heart of a Dog was, again, a breathtaking personal film essay. About memory and childhood, and also about loss. And it's you also bring in the Tibetan Book of the Dead and the 48 days in the Bardo.
49.
I missed one.
Shaving one off.
49 days in the Bardo. I'd love to hear how that film came together, because it has a very collage quality to it, as if it's many, many years in the making, as if the footage is coming straight from your memory. And also your dog, Lolabelle, plays a pretty large role and performs in it. So tell us about Heart of a Dog.
Well, it's really nice to be here on the Art Barge. And actually, Orly Friedman, who's my friend, was the one who said, you really have to come over and do something here. So thank you, Orly, for that. And she brought me to the Art Barge first. Lou and I came over with Orly. And our dog Lolabelle, and it was the first day that suddenly this little perky rat terrier who was running around fell from from the library down the stairs, and she was so agile. We were like, and that when we realized that day she was blind, she was totally blind, and she'd just been faking it. You know, just kind of, I can see, don't.
No.
She was totally blind. And it was, you know, so it was right here. And we thought, wait a second, oh my God. And we kind of went like this. And she went blind very, very fast. And a lot of dogs are fine being blind. You know, they adjust really well. Their sense of smell is exquisite. Their hearing is fantastic. And they don't see that well anyway, so they get, a lot of dogs do very, very well. Lolabelle did not, because she was a kind of CNBC West Village dog who was like, hey, how you doing? It's okay, hi. You know, she was visually attuned to the world, and she had so many friends, and she was like, she was into just contact and, you know, very highly socialized pack animal that just likes packs of people. So she was always like that. So when she went blind, she completely panicked and she froze. She didn't do it. We had to pick her up to go to her food bowl. We had to pick her up to go to her bed. We had to pick her up to take her outside. She was just, you know. And I called a trainer and I said, what, is there anything we can do? And she said, well, I taught my dogs to play piano. I said, why? And so I said, well, let's try it. So we got some keyboards and a lot of electronics, put them on the floor and a bunch of things, mics and bells and instruments. And she learned how to play the piano. And she played piano for a couple of years, every day for an hour. She would run in, turn the keyboards on and play.
I wish we could play some of it now.
Sure, there's a little couple of clips in the film of her playing. And it was, the thing is that music has a way of, it has a real presence, you know, and also she would do these concerts, people would come over to the studio and she would play every day and people would be around her going, that's great, and it would fill the room, you know, sound smashes into the walls and it's architectural, it's a way to be in the world. And music really saved her life. And I think a lot of musicians would say that too. You know, it's a way to be in the world with a, you know. So anyway, she did it. She also did a Christmas record. It was maybe not the greatest Christmas record you ever heard. And she did a lot of benefits also for animal rights organizations playing piano. She was like the B.B. King, you know. She was just like played for treats, like also like had some treats played. It happened also when our vet said, well, you know, you're gonna, Lolabelle is really running short of breath and, you know, she's gonna have to be in an oxygen tent the rest of her life. So I think you might consider letting her go. And so Lou said, where do we get an oxygen tent? So we went and got one and we set it up in our house. She lived 2 more years. She went in, sniffed, got a little, feels better, so she took a little nap, and then she would kind of, she would wander in once in a while, get a little extra oxygen, and she was fine. Really, nobody knows what's gonna happen to you or your dog or your life or anything, so just try to do your best with what you have, you know, and so she was, anyway, when she died, it was a wonderful experience for us. It really was wonderful. And those of you who have an old animal know how tender that can be and just how absolutely sweet it is. And also I learned how to get old from Lolabelle. She taught me how to do that. You know, just like do a little more basking and, you know, slow down a little bit. You don't have to like, be tight, so type A all the time. And I love dogs because they're so skilled with empathy, and I aspire to that more than anything else, is to just try to, what would it be like to be that person or see it from that point of view? Or, I don't know about you, but I'm sick of seeing it from my point of view. I kind of, you know, like to jump out if I can and learn about what it would be like, because I know that I'll never know myself, really, and that doesn't bother me. You know, it's like, so anyway, dogs are really inspiring to me because they study the world. They're aware. They're not asleep. They are looking. They're checking it out, and also dogs like us, which is nice. You know, they actually like us, and they admire us as well. I think one of the big things that they admire is we invented cars. <We're> like, sticking their heads out the window. They like speed, you know. They like to be in, you know, doing stuff and that. So it's nice to be liked, you know. It was like, so I have this, I like the spirit of a dog, you know. It's like just good spirit. So
And at the concert, they like to be together. They're pack animals.
They do, they do.
And they like the sounds that you play for them.
Yeah. Well, they actually just like being with people, you know. I don't know if they like the music or not. Actually, the first time I did this was in Sydney, in Australia. And I did it because I was backstage in a green room at RISD. I was giving the commencement address to some artists, and I was feeling really, really bad because I knew that what I had to say was just so fake. You know, the speech is like, ah, oh. I'm going, don't worry about your student loan. That's not going to cripple you for 20 years. No, no, don't worry about getting a great job in the art world. That'll be so easy. You know, so I'm thinking, what kind of idiot am I? I'm just like, so I'm really depressed. I'm slumped down in that green room and wearing the mortarboard hat. And really hot. Yo-Yo Ma was there too. He was like giving some, I don't know, concert or something. I'm saying to Yo-Yo, because just the way you're chatting and when things are really hot and boring and it's endless ceremony. So I'm saying, you know, Yo-Yo, I have this like fantasy. I'm doing a concert. I look out and I imagine the whole audience is dogs. And he said,
me too.
I've got that fantasy too. Okay. Are you joking? I said, okay, first person who gets to do that invites the other one. So I got to do that first. And he's got a really complicated schedule, much more than mine, so he didn't come. But I did it in Sydney, Australia, and it was so wonderful. It was like, we thought a few hundred dogs would show up, thousands. Dogs.
Wow.
And it was at the Sydney Opera House, so that we had it all marked out for little, medium, big dogs. But they completely overflowed that, and we're up the steps of the Sydney Opera House. So,
wow.
And there were a lot of vets there in their vans because they thought it's going to be like trouble or, you know, dog bites, whatever, and they're ready, and they had all this food out for them. And it's like a short show. It's 20 minutes. It started out with an invocation for whales because right there, if you know the opera house there, it's right next to the water. So whales, dolphins are all right there. So we thought, you know, play some things for them because they're right there. And in the same kind of frequency. And also, you know, why do animals sing anyway? I mean, whales to find each other in the ocean, and dogs really to GPS their world. You know, I'm here, I'm located over there, you know, I'm 2 miles here. It's they make their map, and then they like to get it all figured out. So the show started like that, and then there are a lot of Australian dogs who just want to rock. Not to rock. They were like big guys. Like, so we played some stuff that was like, and they're like, yes. And then my favorite were the front row droolers, and they're like, they don't know why they're there. I mean. Does anyone know why we're here anyway? Anywhere. So they're like, and they were so sweet. And then at the end, we did this. They had all been so polite. You know, they were just like, okay. So then I said, okay, let's make some noise. So little dogs, let's just go. So you know, we got the little dogs. Okay, come on, mediums. Okay, big ones. And for 5 minutes, they barked and howled, and it was the most beautiful sound. It was so beautiful and joyful sound. And it was like, no. I swore, a lot of people then started saying, hey, can you do a dog concert in our town? I was like, I don't want to be the artist who does dog concerts. Now I am, because I've done like six of them already. And the
one that you did in Times Square, weren't there Homeland Security trained dogs there?
Oh, yeah. We invited Homeland Security because they were part of the film. The Homeland Security dogs are part of the Heart of a Dog film. And they came with these massive, gorgeous, big, giant dogs. And their handlers, all the Homeland Security guys. And they came and around the, there's a thing called Midnight Moments, which is just a really cool thing that you do in New York, of showing an art movie at midnight to midnight 03 on 57 screens in Times Square. So all the Nike things and everything suddenly toggle over to your little art film. So it's like, whoa. So that's what we were sort of celebrating. It was 19 degrees or something. No, it was really cold. So everyone's like there. But then they also howled, and I realized this is the Homeland Security dogs also, none of them ever stopped moving. They were all like. And I said to the guys, I said, guys, what's with the dogs? And they said, listen, you know, they're the bomb squad dogs. So they said, you got to worry when they stop moving, because that's when there's a problem. So in other words, when they sniff something, they basically freeze. They don't go, oh my God, there's a bomb. No, they just like, and then the handler does the same thing on the phone, not like, there's a bomb. So all very, under wraps anyway. They didn't bark as much as the other ones, but because they're cops, they're just kind of. So, but the other ones, I thought, how many years has it been since this many dogs howled and barked in Times Square? Probably never.
Yeah.
And so it was really nice to do that. The only time there was, I'm really looking forward to Saturday. Matt goes here from Longhouse, and he made this possible for us to do a concert here. I hope the weather holds up. There's only been one dog fight, and that was in Brighton. And I was the director of the festival there this spring.
Oh, right.
And we did in a beautiful amphitheater also. And to get there, you had to walk along a sidewalk with your dog. And of course, the British are so into dog breeding, and it was like a Noah's Ark of dogs, because each dog was like, so much its own breed, and these really gorgeous dogs, and people were, it was like a dog show, it was like kind of paraded into the amphitheater. And then two terriers got into a fight, and one is going, fuck you, and the other's like, no, fuck you. It was like two soccer guys. We have to stop. Anyway, I hope you come to the
Saturday night. Yeah.
What time?
What time is it Saturday, Matco?
Matco, when is it?
5:00.
Do you have room for more dogs?
Sorry?
Room for more dogs?
Yeah, a few also humans. But
okay.
I agree.
It's not sold out, right?
A few people from here.
You don't have to have a dog to come either. You can just come.
Alan, do we have time for a few questions?
Let me ask Chris.
Do we have time for questions?
Sure.
Okay, great. Terrific.
Just a couple, though.
Just two, yeah.
Yeah, two questions. First hands we see. Be brave. Yes.
I think you are the most empathetic person I've heard in years. It's fantastic. How do you fund all these wonderful brain storms that you have? How do you fund them?
Okay, that's a really good question, because like everyone, like most artists I know, I have a job, and my job is touring. So that's how I usually have funded things. So it's it used to be records, and then the record industry's kind of collapsed. So it used to be that I could just sit around, and they would go, "What's your next record?" And I'd go, "Well," and then you'd sit around for a year in the studio and make your record. Then the record industry evaporated and so a number of industries in New York really collapsed too that were supportive of that system. Mm-hmm. So all of us had to kind of go, now what should I do to support my music or art habit? So that's what. So most of us do touring, you know, just do live shows. So that's my solution. And sometimes, you know, with the Heart of a Dog film, this was like a zero budget film. So it was, you know, I just shot out most of it on a 5D, and just was very, very. And a lot of us is shot here at Laos Point and various places around. So it's a kind of love letter to this area. And that was Arte TV, a French-German channel, because most of the touring I do is Europe, and so they're much more apt to say, "What would you like to do?" You know, and I noticed that first when I was a young artist touring, I would get to Berlin, and they would go, "Would you like to work with the symphony, or would you like to do what kind of project would you like to do? We'd like to fund you." And I was like, "That would never happen in the United States." So. It's, you know, just different ways that, now that project, Heart of a Dog, was like a kind of a no-budget thing, and it was part of their series on why do you make art, make an essay about that. Now, because it's almost zero budget, most people light a candle, put their camera next to the candle, and talk for 25 minutes, and that's the film, you know? So. They're pretty deadly. There are a lot of art films. I mean, I actually like art films like that. You know, somebody mumbling, Lacan, you know, art theory, you know, sort of like.
Or John Giorno sleeping.
Yeah, well, that's a beautiful film, yeah. So so different ways. And I also like to not to try to dream about a big budget project that I couldn't do. I would rather just start a small thing. You can do very dangerous art with a pencil. You know, so don't wait until you have the big budget that's going to solve all your aesthetic problems. It probably won't. Yeah. You know, probably will make it harder. You know, so I try to do, you know, things that are more low key. You know.
One more last question. Yes.
So you've got all this stuff going on. So when do you have time to practice? Do you still practice violin? And when do you have time to meditate? And do you have like a schedule that you keep? Because I have to keep a schedule.
Yeah.
Do you play every day?
No, I don't play every day. But I play when I can, you know, and I try. Some things I try to do really in a coherent way. And so for me, meditation is really important. So I really try to do that.
Every day?
Yeah, and Tai Chi is also something that really means a lot to me. So I try to learn about that. And I inherited a big weapons collection. So my ambition is to learn how to use them. These are big Tai Chi swords and Guando things. And the martial arts are really inspiring to me. And it's particularly in the weapons things, because it's about energy, and it's about learning how to use it, and when you see a beautiful move like this, you might see something in the park, people going like this, and you're going, what is that beautiful move? Decapitation. It's a martial art, you know. It is about, you know, but it's also about a dance with an invisible person, and I can definitely relate to that. So. Each thing is using energy back and forth, and it's for me probably the thing that gives me the most energy at this point, and so it doesn't feel like a discipline that I need to do. Oh, but I have a really wonderful teacher, Master Ren Guanyi, who's he's really, really inspiring. And so for me, what I really like to do is find really good teachers. Mm-hmm. That's what matters to me. And I have several really good teachers. And I just try to learn from them, you know. So that's my discipline with that.
Well, I think that's where we can end. I want to just say that.